So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andrew Light. I'm Associate Director of the Institute for Philosophy and Public Policy at George Mason University. And I want to welcome you to our session on, which is the true title of which was on the flyers and not in the program, from professional training, from philosophical training to professional blogging. And this this event is sponsored by the APA Committee on Public Philosophy, chaired by Eric Weber, who's here with us from the University of Mississippi. And I want to thank them at the outset for the generous support they gave to put on this session. So the idea of the session really kind of started with some very casual, certainly unscientific, slightly empirical observations that I made after moving to Washington about 4 years ago, and finding myself not only at George Mason, but as a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress, where I met Matt Yglesias, who is now at Slate, as I'll introduce him more fully in a second, but at the time was blogging for us at Think Progress. And I noticed then and remembered that that Matt and a friend of mine from Seattle, Dave Roberts, were both fantastic bloggers and also both had backgrounds in philosophy. And then looking further, I sort of noticed that Andrew Sullivan, one of America's most distinguished bloggers, also has a background in philosophy. Started putting things together and going, is there something about this medium of blogging that's really come into its own, certainly in the last 10 years? Is there something about the training that we get as philosophers and political philosophers? And I don't mean anything sort of about particular aspects of any particular kind of philosophical training, but just basically trained in the discipline and brought up to cherish good sheer argumentation. Is there something about that maelstrom into which philosophers are born that actually helps also to make for a good professional blogger? And talking with Eric about this about a year ago, we decided, well, would it be a good idea to actually try to get some of these guys in a room at the APA and talk about this in the context of the mission of the APA Committee on Public Philosophy, which is to try to help to bring philosophical work in the United States more to the public realm. So I was happy to put it together and very pleased when David Roberts, Andrew Sullivan, and Matt Yglesias all agreed to join us on this panel. So we'll have a conversation among the three of them for almost an hour, and then we'll open it up for questions after that. But let me just, by way of a few words, by way of introduction of each of them. David Roberts, to my immediate left, is a staff writer.
The one with the beard.
Right. The one with the beard is a staff writer at the environmental magazine Grist. He received an MA in philosophy at the University of Montana, and then went on to a PhD in philosophy at the University of Alberta. He chose to leave towards the end of our discussion. We'll ask him exactly why he chose to leave. He's decided he wants to tell us this. And he turned to environmental journalism, winding up at Grist, where he has become one of the most influential opinion and reporting voices on the environment in the United States today. In between Dave and Andrew Sullivan there is Matt Yglesias, who is currently the business and economics correspondent at Slate. He was previously at Think Progress, as I mentioned before, The Atlantic, TPM Media, and The American Prospect. He's the author of Heads in the Sand, How the Republicans Screw Up Foreign Policy and Foreign Policy Screws Up the Democrats, and the author of the forthcoming book with Simon and Schuster, The Rent is Too Damn High, which is coming out in March, I believe.
Yes.
You don't get to have books with these kinds of titles. You stay in professional philosophy, so that's one, I think.
Still it.
Plus in the column of the blogging profession. And Matt received his BA in philosophy from Harvard. And then on my far left, but not to my far left, is Andrew Sullivan, who is he's the founder, editor, and lead writer, as many of you know, for The Dish, one of the world's most widely read bloggers. He started blogging in 2000 after a very successful career in journalism, where for 5 years he was editor at The New Republic, and then moved the blog The Dish to several places, including most recently theatlantic.com in 2007, then The Daily Beast in April of 2010. He earned his PhD in political science in the government department at Harvard with a dissertation on Michael Oakeshott, and among other books is the author of An Argument About Homosexuality, Intimations Pursued, The Voice of Practice in the Conversation of Michael Oakeshott, and The Conversation, Conservative Soul, Fundamentalism, Freedom, and the Future of the Right. So just to get us started, if each of you just will start with David, could walk us through the intellectual journey. You went to a master's degree program in philosophy at the University of Montana, finished there, went out to Alberta. Could you walk us through just your journey from your academic interest to your current work today?
Sure. I've actually thought about this quite a lot in the past, and it's odd to find an audience that might actually find it interesting. That's probably the only audience on the planet that would care about this. But when I was in school, in college, and grad school, my main areas of interest were cognitive science, how the brain works and how consciousness works, etc., and ethics. And so, as I thought about those things, you know, in ethics, I was always a utilitarian, and I sort of. So, like all utilitarians, I had to grapple with the trolley problem, the famed trolley problem, and I really grappled with it, and it was always hugely unsatisfying to me, the trolley problem as it's framed. I assume everybody here knows what the trolley problem is, uniquely in the world, this room full of people. So I was always hugely dissatisfied with the trolley problem. This is going to have a point eventually. And you know, I was thinking, like, why do I find this problem so unsatisfying the way it's phrased? Like, I don't want to answer. I don't want to answer this problem the way it's phrased. And so I thought about it a lot. And there a couple of things I thought, well, in the real world, you know, obviously it's just an intuition pump. It's stripped out of real world circumstances. But I was thinking, in the real world, even if you were in that situation, you would have to be thinking about not just X number of lives versus Y number of lives, but you know, what is the probability that your effort to put the trolley on the other track will work? Or what are the probabilities that if you succeed in getting on the other track, you know, maybe one of the four or five people could jump out of the way or something, or the one person could jump out of the way. So in other words, to make a good decision in that situation, you'd have to be very sensitive to circumstances, to empirical circumstances. And as I thought about the trolley problem, I thought, well, it matters less what you would do in that situation than, you know, and this is sort of what brought me around to rule utilitarianism, which is, what should people do in situations like that to maximize the good over the long term? So the sort of temporal aspect to it, this historical aspect to it, also gets stripped out of the trolley problem. And so I thought, well, you know, what would a person who is sensitive to circumstances and sensitive to how their decision will affect social norms in the future decide to do? And as I thought about that, I thought, well, what kind of person would be good at making those decisions? It wouldn't necessarily be a person who has studied ethics or is familiar with a lot of ethical theory. It would be a person who is sensitive to circumstances, empathetic, has some degree of historical consciousness, is good at sort of empirical analysis, like what are the results of my actions in a given course. And so, in other words, I thought, what should a person do in the trolley problem? The answer is whatever a sensitive and well-informed and well-adjusted moral agent would do. So I thought, well, if we want people to make the right decision in trolley problems or similar problems, the thing to do maybe is not figure out abstractly, ethically, what the right thing to do is. The right thing to do is to create good moral agents, to create people who are well-adjusted and sensitive to circumstances and have some historical consciousness, etc. And so I thought, well, how do you create those people? You don't do it via philosophy. You do it by, you know, good prenatal care, good daycare, you know, good early childhood development, good nutrition, you know, you do it by creating healthy people, and education is obviously part of that too, but not even the biggest part, I don't think. And so I thought, well, so if I really want to find out the right answer to the trolley problem, what I need to do is create a really good moral agent and find out what he or she would do. And so how do I create good moral agents? Well, how do you get good prenatal care and daycare and et cetera? That's, you do it through public policy. You do it through government. And so it was following this train of thought from the trolley problem that sort of led me, intellectually at least, out of philosophy and into the realm of public policy and trying to influence public policy to the extent I could to try to help, insofar as it's possible, create the sort of public policies that create good people. So that's the intellectual side of it. The actual history of it is one damn thing after another and not that interesting.
Right. I'm more just all straight up one damn thing after another. I remember it was I signed up for a intro philosophy class, right first semester as a freshman, because sometimes senior year in high school, my poor AP physics teacher was like trying to show me some equation, and I kept saying to him, yeah, but what is gravity? You just have a ratio. What is it? And he said, well, you should take a philosophy class. So I did, and I never got the answer to that question, and I feel bitter about it. But I grew up in a family of writers. My father's a novelist and a screenwriter. His mother was a novelist and a journalist. His father wrote plays and novels. His brother's a screenwriter and a journalist. My mom was not a writer, but she worked at Newsweek in the design department. So I was always surrounded by words and things like that. And then I was fascinated and really gripped when I learned about use versus mention. Which, I guess most people find, most people in the writing world find to be a very fussy, I get into fights with editors about should commas be inside or outside of quotation marks, and why people shouldn't use scare quotes, because it completely confuses, using words and mentioning them. But it brought open to my eyes, actually, it's this entirely different sort of dimension of language and the idea that you could think about it, and that it had certain kinds of depth and importance that I think, everyone is using language. Everyone obviously has some kind of, notions about it. But I find that even writers tend to be a little bit oddly cavalier, at least from the point of view of someone who's studied even the most sort of basic questions around this, and that really stuck with me. So I wound up in the major, where you then of course get the problem that every time you go back home, your parents' friends are like, so what kind of job do you think you're gonna do, and what they all tell you is, you should go to law school. The professors. maybe they tell you you should apply to grad school if they're more impressed with your work, but mine were not telling me that necessarily. But I really didn't want to be a lawyer. It just seemed really terrible, and I was perhaps trapped. But I had this blog thing going on when I was a junior and senior in college, and fortunately at around that time some. Of the sort of smaller political magazines in DC were trying to build out their websites, but no writers wanted to write for the internet at this point, because it was very low prestige. So sort of more junior people got tasked with running the websites, and they were desperate to hire entry-level people who liked the internet and would work for basically no money, which is, that's a key part of the journalism business model. A couple of people had reached out to me. They were like, Matt, we have this terrible job that pays nothing, and you should apply. And so I did, because it would delay at least my inevitable law school application to go do this other thing. And then I was spring of my senior year, I'd nailed this one job down, and I was doing a like oral, you know, thesis defense kind of thing, and it turned out there were some like major conceptual errors in my project, and so we finish up, and it's time for small talk, and Christine Korsgaard asks me, you know, what are your plans after you graduate? And I said, well, you know, I've got this job at a magazine, and she kind of looks at me and she says, that seems to be about your speed. Which, you know, is a categorical imperative, nice thing to say to your students. And but anyway, you know, she was right, I thought, and you know, it was my speed, and I've always enjoyed, you know, working at the short, you know, philosophical writing is extraordinarily exacting, and in a lot of ways is the reverse of like writing 250 words and hitting publish on something. And it's so much more suited to my temperament to like work at a high pace and write a lot and blah, 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 rather than agonize over every little thing. But I do always feel that it sort of touched me in an important way in how I think about problems and what kinds of things I'm interested in, even if the method and the pace of what I do now is really at the other end.
Andrew?
Well, I guess the two questions. One is, how did you walk backwards into philosophy? And the other is, how did you fall headlong into blogging? The first is quite straightforward, really. I didn't come from a family of writers or readers. There were basically no books in my house when I grew up, and neither of my parents or my sister or brother went to college. So, this dude doesn't just, he just like speaks really loudly, this guy, whoever he is.
Sorry, we're working on it.
But I was very interested in politics as a kid, and got very interested in it, and studied history, and got a scholarship to Oxford, where I studied history and modern languages and literature. And I thought about studying theology, but I didn't want to lose my faith too soon. So I kind of decided theology wasn't going to work. Philosophy at Oxford is just, as far as I could tell, just word games that I just couldn't even begin to ponder the salience or relevance of them, and conducted by people far smarter than I was. And so I stuck with history. Then when I got a second chance, I was at a political career at Oxford and was leading among the sort of next wave of conservative young things, as it were, most of whom are now running the country back home. I genuinely got a scholarship to Harvard to study whatever I wanted, and I genuinely thought, you know, I don't really know why I hold these opinions. I haven't really drilled down to the first principles of them. And that's probably a good idea, age 21, to figure out why you instinctively lean towards what's called the right. So I was supposed to do a Master of Public Administration, which is basically teaching you how to be a bureaucrat at the Kennedy School. I set a record of taking 15 of 16 courses outside of the Kennedy School because it was just so dreadful, and took them all in history and philosophy. Mainly political and moral philosophy. And the only place you could really do that at Harvard was in the government department, because philosophy had killed off any genuine pursuit of ideas or thoughts or questions that people have about their lives. That was, so if I could tell, economic philosophy had
decided... We'll be having a reception later at Emerson Hall, if anyone...
So I could tell, academic philosophy decided that was utterly uninteresting and beside the point. So I had to go into political theory to study philosophy. And that's where I ended up. And loved it and was fascinated by it, and slowly came to some better provisionary conclusions about why I held the views that I held, and jettisoned some others. And that's really you know, how I approached journalism, which was trying to figure out, I know it sounds weird, but to try and make that old distinction between opinion and truth, and to engage in the the balancing act between the two, the dialectic between the two, in which you test opinion. And I have to say, the Plato's dialogues remain for me sort of a critical introduction to exactly that kind of discussion. I mean, that's what it's about. What appears to be true, what we believe to be true, and what is true, and there is seemed to be some gap that is interesting to traverse. When I fell into blogging, the most exciting thing for me about it was lack of any editor. Because I'm a generation at least older than Matt, even though reading him you wouldn't even begin to think that. And I had toiled in the vineyards of print journalism, both newspaper and edited a weekly, put out 250 issues of a weekly magazine. The liberation of being able to talk out loud and to think provisionally in print, in other words, to offer a half thought or the beginnings of an argument as an invitation to continue that argument or conversation, is something that the blogosphere allowed one to do in real time in a way that print just didn't. Because print requires a finished object that you polish and put out there. Yes, you can get great responses back after a small interval, but there is a difference between that and a constantly interrupted conversation, which is what blogging really created. So what blogging created for me was, in fact, a platonic dialogue between me and what started out as 150 readers and is now 1.5 million people, which creates problems of scale in terms of, but in terms of that ongoing conversation, I have to say that in the 12 years that I've been running this blog, the conversational and argumentative and open-ended and platonic dialogue version of it has emerged as the strongest sort of theme and consistency in it, which is really a philosophical endeavor. If you believe, as I do, that philosophy is really just asking questions about things that we don't quite know the answer to.
That's great. I actually want to pick up right on that for my next round of questions with the three of you. It's certainly the case that all three of you have written explicitly about philosophical topics in your work. Matt made reference to Kripke's philosophy of language in an amazing piece of creativity on PolitiFact's rating of Paul Ryan's of the Democratic accusation that Paul Ryan was trying to kill off Medicare as the lie of the year, the political lie of the year. So Matt made explicit reference to Kripke in that post. Dave, you've had some wonderful posts where you've really engaged with work, contemporary work on moral psychology and thinking about moral motivations for transforming essentially the economy to one that's relies less on carbon, and Andrew, in throughout your work, indeed in your book itself, and then throughout your blogging, you touch on not only the foundations of conservatism and libertarianism, but also very interesting topics in theology as well. Those pop up, but they're professional philosophers or people who get their paycheck from universities to be professional philosophers who blog about philosophy. So that's what I'm more interested in. In terms of the sort of the public, the sense in which what you're doing is a kind of public philosophy, in the range of political topics that you engage in, the way in which you do indeed engage with the public, and the way that blogging uniquely makes this kind of possible. So let me just read a quote, and then oddly enough, it's a quote from Andrew, and then I'll ask Andrew to respond to himself. A quote from the 2008 essay, which I would recommend to everyone, Why I Blog, which really describes, I think almost Aristotelian terms, the relationship that's created between the reader and the writer in an uninterrupted way through blogging. Alone in front of a computer, Andrew writes, at any moment are two people, a blogger and a reader. The proximity is palpable, the moment human. Whatever authority a blogger has is derived not from the institution he works for, but from the humanness he conveys. This is writing with emotion, not just under, but always breaking through the surface. It renders a writer and a reader not just connected, but linked in a visceral, personal way. The only term that really describes this is friendship, and it is a relatively new thing to write for thousands and thousands of friends. So if you all could sort of, we'll start with Dave again, just kind of reflect on the way in which part, at least part of what you're doing is kind of engaging in a public philosophical discussion, even if it's not explicitly about a philosophical topic.
Sure, sure. Well, I mean, obviously the best thing philosophical training gave me in terms of being a blogger is just how to spot an argument and how to dissect an argument and how to make arguments. But also what drew me to philosophy in the first place and what ended up sort of drawing me out of philosophy is I'm sort of like by temperament a synthesizer. I like to see the connections among diverse things, and I like to see how those connections illuminate diverse things. And you know, it turned out in philosophy, it was very much encouraged to do the opposite, to to dissect further and further someone's interpretation of someone else's. But so one of the things it seems to me that bedevils politics in DC is that there is a dialogue that has certain parameters and certain shapes and certain terms that disadvantage, in my mind, progressives generally and environmentalists, and sort of limit the terms of the debate. So one of the things that I like to try to do is, pull the lens back and talk about broader questions, which end up being, ethical questions and moral questions and political philosophy questions that try to sort of show that these terms are limited and show that there are other ways of talking about these subjects and other connections to make, and there are legitimate philosophical and ethical grounds for progressives to use in these fights, and they don't have to be limited to the sort of field of battle that's been drawn out for them, which is sort of on which it seems to me they're sort of set up to lose. You know, and sort of one thing where this, one area where this comes into play quite often is if you're ever writing about environmentalism, you're constantly sort of confronted by cost-benefit analysis, sort of how many lives will be saved by X law, and is that worth it? Is that worth the cost to industry? And it's always struck me that the way these cost-benefit analyses are conducted is in very narrow terms, where it becomes very hard to justify progressive public policy. And so, one of the things I've tried to do, particularly around climate change, and climate change is rife with really fascinating ethical questions and dilemmas. But one of the things about climate change is you have this really long time scale, really large numbers you're dealing with, which are hard to, hard to fathom in terms of possible damages and possible loss of life and possible costs. And you have, sort of, rather than cost-benefit analysis assuming a certain sort of economy, you have a certain kind of economy that's threatened, and you have the question of, like, what's the cost-benefit analysis on shifting to a different kind of economy, which is a very much broader question. And and it's all rife with uncertainties in terms of costs and in terms of the impacts of climate change. So one of the things I've tried to do is pull back the lens and show that when you're trying to do cost-benefit analysis on such a huge scale, centuries involved, possibly civilization-threatening consequences, trillions of dollars of costs, you end up receding away from economics, it seems to me, and getting to the realm of ethics, of principles, of sort of, a precaution, like the precautionary principle, things like that, which are less about bean counting and more about sort of what sort of society do we want to be, like questions about what sort of legacy do we want to leave, and things like this. And these sort of fuzzy questions, tend to irritate the economists who are doing the cost-benefit analysis, but it seems to me that the public would benefit from having a much broader conversation. And I just am trying to show progressives and environmentalists what are the terms of that broader conversation, and sort of what are the terms of these broader ethical issues, and sort of give them a language and a set of questions to ask and a set of, ways to break out of this very limited debate that they're stuck in and losing too often. So that's where.
Okay, so but briefly before we turn to Matt, though, what about the friendship part? Do you really, because you and I, when I lived in Seattle, you and I briefly talked about me starting a blog on Grist or becoming a blogger for Grist.
Right, right.
And you said you would hate it because people would fire back at you these unbelievably annoying, asinine questions all the time that you'd pull your hair out. So do you feel like you're engaged with a community with your readership?
Yeah, well, it used to be, I'm trying to think of a non-boring answer to this. To me, the community and friendship part has somewhat moved out of the blog and over to Twitter. I don't know if anybody even knows what Twitter is, but Twitter is, like Andrew's description of blogging is doubly apt for Twitter and sort of the immediacy. So what I tend to do now is write much longer pieces than I used to, than our typical blog pieces. Too long, as Matt will tell you. sort of long, knotty, thinky pieces on the blog, and then sort of move over to Twitter and have real-time conversations about those pieces on Twitter. But in that sphere, yes, I have dozens of people who I consider friends in a strange way, even though I've never met them and only know them by tiny little square avatars that I see. But I've learned an immense amount that way and have found the quality of the questions, actually, and the quality of the feedback and everything much better on that than I ever did on the blog. Don't know if your experience is similar.
Yeah. Well, so much of journalism as it was traditionally done in sort of post-war United States, particularly in print and particularly in America, was built around certain kinds of strategies of establishing authoritativeness and of, to an extent, like obscuring from readers the fact that these articles are human products that are written by people, and that some like the Economist magazine takes it to the greatest extreme, where they actually obliterate the identities of the people writing the things, and everything's anonymous, everything's in a house style. But there's also a a kind of implicit journalistic epistemology that's relied on in newspaper reporting. There's a convention as to what constitutes, an objective report, and to what reads like a proper newspaper article. And a lot of that is practical in nature. A lot of that's really a business strategy from a particular point in time. But when people work in a community and they're doing it, with a public role, right? I mean, the people who cover the White House and cover Congress for major newspapers are performing a public role on matters of great consequence. But the tendency is to shy away from that fact, to act as if they're not playing a public role and as if they're not commenting on matters of great consequence, I think. That they're somehow invisible conduits through which like facts move from Capitol Hill into your living room. And writing on the web for a variety of reasons, but one of them being that kind of immediacy that Andrew was talking about has never really had that character and is much more about, there's a different strategy of representing the truth, of coming across as authentic to people. And it lets you, I think, try to dig deeper, and not just say, well, this is some stuff that some people said, and maybe this happened. But to try to really like dig at the questions. I mean, that can be, what are the stakes, the way Dave was putting it, or just what's the truth about some hotly disputed point. To say, I've changed my mind. To even just, as Andrew was alluding before, to concede that your views on the world are a work in progress, and that sometimes, sometimes important things pop up on your radar screen, like there's a civil war in Libya, and you might have some thoughts about it without being like an expert or having a detailed knowledge or really worked out view, and so you might want to say something, hear what other people say something again, have an iterative sort of discovery process, and all that is very antithetical to how journalism has normally been done, but I think lets you try to play a different kind of public role to say, you know, I'm a person who has an audience, who has some interests, who I feel like I have certain responsibilities to try to address things if they're important, to try to get it right, but to also to speak up when I can, to correct myself, to change my mind when I'm wrong, hopefully, in a way that I think is very different from the institutional dynamics of sort of conventional places. Although now I think a lot of those old-fashioned and I think wrong-headed dynamics are moving online in some ways. It's following us.
Yeah, I think everything that Matt said is true. In some ways, it's like the bloggers went up to the Wizard of Oz and ripped the curtain mm-hmm. apart and showed little Ruth Marcus sitting in there tapping out the accepted truth.
Harvard and the Washington Post are our targets in the room, if you're wondering.
You know, a little shocked that she'd been suddenly revealed. And there have been lots of rear guard actions to try and drag that curtain back and not, you know, expose Fred Hyatt and his group of people at the Washington Post. All of which, of course, I find fantastic. And I think to some extent, insofar as the founders of this country wanted a republic of letters in a way, and we read the Federalist Papers, that they are also an open-ended, and they assumed identities, almost avatars, to write these things and to debate important matters. And when you look at what actually now happens in Congress, you find almost none of this going on. When you switch on cable news, you find almost none of it actually happening. But the blogosphere has risen to do that in ways that I think allows that kind of, as Matt put it, open-ended conversation. I'm going to give you just a very recent example in my case of deciding I would endorse Ron Paul for the Republican nomination, and then being dragged, kicking and screaming by my readers through every old newsletter he ever wrote,
You put this post up on Christmas Eve, so I was kind of wondering, wow.
Well, because the pressure was so intense, you don't even get to duck Christmas as a blogger. And that's the other thing, a columnist can put out a column like once a week or so, and it sits there in stone. And they can duck an issue. They can have written something that's clearly misguided 3 weeks later, but never feel the necessity to correct themselves. A blogger, when I say these friends, I mean they're friends in a good and bad way. They're friends.
Frenemies.
They're friends from hell, in as much as Zach, don't tweet that my readers are friends from hell. Okay, go ahead. they don't let you get away with stuff, and they make you address gaps in your arguments or seeming inconsistencies. Now that's a philosophical endeavor, it seems to me, and it's actually a higher level of honesty, I think, because of the lack of authority that we have. I think we actually cherish our lack of authority as an advantage. And I think those bloggers that are seeking authority are playing the old game, which is the old Washington game, which is, I have more clout than you in this town because what I said matters, as opposed to, I think this seems true to me, and for these reasons, don't you? And hope that at some point the consensus will emerge out of an actual lesser power struggle than an actual truth debate. And that is a philosophical, in many ways, contribution to a political situation.
I want to redirect back to Matt, just taking some of this into account, but you put out a series of, I think, brief, wonderfully brief, but also remarkably, almost moving posts in June 2007 when Richard Rorty died. And you said a couple things about really how philosophy in the mirror of nature had helped you to think about what you wanted to do with your career and stuff. And I remember, obviously a number of years before that, Rorty had been in a prolonged exchange with Tom McCarthy in Critical Inquiry, which don't expect people to have remembered. But one of the points that Rorty kept going back to again and again was how he thought that a lot of what we thought was the sort of the public role of philosophy, what it used to be, could be taken up by journalists. And he wrote this years before like blogging ever kind of evolved. So anything about like what you saw in Rorty sort of transferring to the kind of the role that you think you play now in the work that you do?
Sure. I mean, unlike Andrew, I mean, I was really at one point in my life was quite taken with the sort of the word games and you know, possibly alleged exclusion.
Did you just use scare quotes?
I did. It's terrible. from the world, and I was really tripped up on, I guess, like the, you know, sophomore level problems of philosophy as taught to undergraduates. And it was like, it was really bothering me, like a lot, that I couldn't, you know, figure out. I don't know, you know, and to try to say it a lot of times, people be like, you know, you sound like you're high or something. But, but you know, like I was upset about this stuff and, you know, how did words refer to things or whatever. I know it's not always, you know, the popular view among professionals, but I really liked Rorty's books when I saw them, just because they suggested to me, and then I saw again later in Wittgenstein, you know, just a suggestion of like a way out rather than a solution to some of these dilemmas, but just an idea that I don't even know if this is the correct interpretation, but that it's possible to overthink, you know, these things, and that you need to find a way to put them aside and ask yourself what really matters in life and what are the big, you know, the big concerns of the world. And in a way, that's what Dave was saying. But, you know, I think that it remains true that there are these very big, weighty principles at stake all the time in everyday decisions that tend to get obscured in some of the, you'll hear people talk about, you know, immigration policy. You'll hear them talk, you know, maybe on CNN or in the Capitol or in newspapers. And people will talk a lot about sort of like little factual questions, you know, like, is it true that illegal immigrants from Mexico beheaded someone somewhere in the Arizona desert? As if like huge things turn on these little analytic points. When really there's like a huge value question, like, do the interests of people born in Mexico count in our decision making, right? Are they people or aren't they? And you know, they try to like keep that off, you know, MSNBC, because it's not, it doesn't make for great television. But these are, you know,
it would, I think.
Maybe so. A good 2-minute segment, you know, will just establish the humanity of foreigners.
That would be a great leap forward on Fox News. Right?
Absolutely, yeah. No, but you know, but like this stuff, it matters in a lot of ways, and they're philosophical questions of a sort. I mean, they're not great like dissertation topics, but they obviously, you know, are. One's views on this are very much informed by the kinds of issues that political philosophers are talking about in technical and less technical ways kind of over the years. And I think it's healthy in a lot of ways to try to have the people who are talking about public affairs issues try to bring these out on the table a little bit more, you know, discuss them with some level of rigor, that to sort of decide that the questions of ultimate value are too difficult and so we're going to pretend they don't exist and instead have like a kind of pointless, you know, quibbling argument about statistics, I think really sort of impoverishes the public realm. And ideally, these are the kinds of things journalists should be talking about, along with, you know, the reporting and the research and whatever else is there.
I'm very much in agreement with Matt on that. Here's one thing I did mention, which is not to do with blogging, which is that, you know, I came of age as the gay rights movement in the US and the UK was kind of struggling. And my response to that was to write a book of philosophy. Virtue Normal is a philosophical book, really. It's about the limits of politics. And it, you know, it treats, from whether it's Aristotle and Aquinas, Foucault, Burke, Mill, It is a work of political philosophy in which what it tried to do was say this burgeoning current question of the homosexual in society has to be tackled. There are different ways of tackling it and seeing it. In other words, I tried to break down: are you pro-gay or you were anti-gay? Which was, as I discovered, was a sort of dead end. I mean, it just became one side proving their moral superiority to the other, and vice versa, and no conversation having really taking place. But if you broke it down and try to explain to people, there's this position that makes a certain amount of sense on these premises, there's this position, and so you take them through natural law, through post-structuralism, through the liberal tradition, through the sort of small c conservative tradition, and you point, and my argument was that none of these existing philosophical traditions was doing justice to this particular public policy question, and made a proposition. Now, some people would argue, I think, that kind of exercise is way too esoteric for the public realm. I mean, who's going to buy a book about Foucault? Apart from the academics. And the academics, especially in queer theory, thought I was Satan. So they weren't ever going to support this. But I think, in many ways, when I look back at my own career, that was probably the most important work I've done. Because it actually made an argument for marriage equality based upon solid philosophical foundations and historical foundations that has held up very well as an argument, both in public discourse and in the courts and elsewhere, in ways that has clearly, I'm happy to say, played one part, very complicated story, but one part in clarifying and advancing the rights of a small minority of people. And that's a good thing. And I don't think it would have been as successful if the arguments hadn't been honed so thoroughly. And they were honed by me, among others, by, again, giving, first of all, starting out with an essay, then taking that essay on the road to various colleges and engaging in a dialogue with people and finding the most salient criticisms and tackling them one by one in an ongoing process over 10 years, then finalizing in a book and then continuing that conversation on a blog. And that seems to be an amazing and very productive fusion of philosophy and politics. And happily, I also think there is a group, not a very large group, but a serious group of human beings interested in reading and contributing to that debate, aware that they may not immediately have a huge impact, but these little seeds grow and flourish in time. And if you can change the structure of the argument, which it helps to have a philosophic training in doing yeah. so, then you can have huge political dividends in ways that most people operating in the political sphere are too busy doing their daily news cycle talking points shit. excuse me. It was the only word that really seemed to apply. They miss. But if I were to ask myself, why have we won on that question, the victories that we have, I really do believe it's because we got the better arguments.
Mm-hmm. You know, I was big into pragmatists, the American pragmatists, and was at one point almost got into Penn State. That's part of the one damn thing after another that I didn't get into earlier. But I remember those posts by Matt from Rorty, and I remember thinking before, and you know, that helped me sort of make it concrete. But you know, part of pragmatism is, and this maybe it goes against what Andrew was describing earlier. But sort of one of the thrusts of pragmatism is that we're not really on a quest to find these eternal, immutable truths. We're creating, you know, the answer of who we are and what's true and what's good. We're creating those answers through our words and behavior continuously. And sort of, if you buy that, then it seems to me, you know, at that point, you've done the philosophy, and the fun thing to do is to get out and take part in creating those answers, you know, take part in the act of sort of determining the answers to those questions. And that can only be done in and among the public. So, the pragmatists, I think this was sort of the theme of your post, which is that sort of the pragmatists led me out of philosophy, and that's kind of, I had the same experience.
But I would argue that it hasn't. that in my case, at least, I still really believe philosophy is superior to practice, and that the point of philosophy is not to make practice more effective, but to ponder questions that are unanswerable, and that therefore politics, for me, and this is probably what makes me not a progressive, is not the solution to human problems. There are certain ways it can resolve certain contingent problems of arranging a society, but it is not an answer in any way to the human condition, which requires religion or philosophy to complete it. So I think that's a distinction. I'm more in some ways clinging to an older idea of what philosophy is than my colleagues here.
But you do describe blogging as essentially postmodern in some ways. In that way that sort of the truth is being, not the truth itself is being revised, but the sort of the
that's
arguments about
what I think you could draw a distinction between postmodernism and skepticism.
Yeah.
Postmodernism assumes there is no truth. Skepticism assumes there may well be, but we're not quite sure, and we could never really grasp it. So the trick for me, which is where I'm more a sort of early mid-career Oakeshott than I am a late-career Rorty, although late-career Rorty came around to liking Oakeshott in the end,
yeah.
But only by misunderstanding him.
you can tweet that. That'll go like fire on Twitter. Live tweet that one.
Viral.
It's huge.
It'll go viral. Yeah.
It's like when Oakeshott called in his presence Isaiah Berlin the Paganini in political philosophy. That didn't even get a response here. So I still cling to sort of, in the end, politics is all a matter of failure. And can make things a little better, can also make things a lot worse, and philosophy must remain a sort of harbor from all of it.
Do you want to jump in, Matt? Or?
Well, I just, you know, to say, I don't know exactly how this relates to what Dave was saying, but that, you know, living in Washington and talking to political people all the time, I'm struck always by the idea that like genuine persuasion about big ideas is in some ways the most underrated factor in politics. That there's a tendency to, you know, people spend a lot of time kind of honing their talking points and very kind of glibly assuming that people are going to pursue self-interest and that certain kinds of you know, things can't be called for and so on and so forth. But that if you look back at, you know, historical change over epochs, clearly at one point in time, like, let's get guns and kill these Indians and steal their land was like a really like a winning policy proposal in the United States. Whereas today, nobody is going to say, let's get some guns, kill these Canadians, and steal their land.
Not yet.
No, but you know, I mean, they really won't. And that's like an epic change in human values in a democratic society that has taken place in a, you know, a long span of time, but relative to the length of the existence of human civilization, like relatively short. People change and have had profound changes of belief about race, about sexual orientation, things like that. And so, you know, in some way, these kinds of arguments about, you know, the biggest, most abstract ideas about, you know, in-groups and out-groups and human equality and so on and so forth, make a huge amount of difference. And yet people kind of working in the policy world and trying to think about how to move their agendas forward, I think give just enormously short shrift to the idea that sort of public values change and that, you know, widely held consensus about what is and isn't acceptable can change quite a lot.
But my point is simply that people will find a way to be miserable even despite this progress.
Sure.
And that all this is relative. Not that we shouldn't make the progress, but it's not really leading to some fundamental solution. And if we don't believe in going in and killing lots of, we do believe we have the right to go into another country without and do the same thing. And even now, you have people writing about why are we allowing them? Why are we not keeping troops in Iraq? It's ours, isn't it? So, these things are eternal, these impulses.
Right,
and
right.
We learn maybe very slowly. But I'm not going to disagree with you, Matt, because I think the evidence is overwhelming. You know, human beings have made progress, and I think great ideas have spurned have spawned that progress. But in the end, as Enoch Powell said, every political career ends in failure, every single one, because the problems that they succeeded in solving have given way to new problems, which they can't solve. And so even our greatest politicians end as failures.
Well, one final question on this, and then we open it up to the audience. But even with that conclusion, using the example that you gave of gay marriage, I mean, where there's clearly there is some value in the, everyone seems to agree there's value in aspiring to have the public conversation about values, which is very difficult, especially very difficult if you're only doing philosophy, you know, in an insular fashion among other philosophers. So where are the opportunities, would you all say, for trying to have, you know, we had some good examples given so far, other examples where we might see opportunities for a great clarifying conversation?
Well, for example, I think the candidacy of Ron Paul, whether one regards it as a nightmare or salvation, nonetheless has put big ideas onto the table in a way that others have not. I mean, certainly within the Republican universe. And the debate around those things, for example, primarily non-interventionism abroad, and to some extent crony capitalism at home. Here you have a guy, 77 years old, and clearly someone obsessed with. I mean, this is a man who in a Republican primary debate is asked, what's your favorite book? And says, Frédéric Bastiat's La Loi. You know, well, I have to say, I have to give him credit for that. I mean, he didn't say Jesus like one previous intellectual president did. And one fears that Obama would never hesitate to say what he really enjoyed reading or found important. For fear of giving Daniel Pipes too much pleasure. But so there you have a man with big ideas, a huge idea about the limits of government that is really quite radical, just as Obama seemed in many ways, although to some people, not to me, but to some people, to have a similarly big idea about. So these things do work. They work quite effectively, and yet, but you see, I think Washington journalists just can't handle that stuff. They're too scared. They know that their most important thing in their lives is never to take a stand on any important issue. That's their lodestar. And secondly, is to get the cheapest, quickest story into a paper, preferably around some gaffe or something that they can get the news cycle moving on. So they don't get it. So I think it's up to us to find a way to connect those ideas to the political process.
Yeah, and I would say what are the opportunities for this is the democratization of media that blogging is a signal sort of chapter of, and Twitter as well, and God knows what else is coming, but the opportunities are everywhere now, and it's been my experience that there is an enormous hunger out there for discussion of these larger questions of values and things like that, and I get immense response when I'm always somewhat nervous about writing a post that seems abstract and kind of, you know, wonky and philosophical, but I always get really positive response, even from people who disagree with me. My experience is that, I don't know if this is unique to this moment in history, but it sort of seems like that to me, that we're at this pivot point in the U.S. where we are confronting really big questions about what's next and, you know, who we are and what our values are, and I think there's enormous hunger for that.
I mean, the proudest statistic on my website is that 50% are atheists and 50% are believers. And in our climate right now, there aren't very, very many places where you could say that in terms of readership. That kind of even division, in which both sides feel that even though I'm on the believer side, I will give the atheists a fair shake. On a Sunday, which is when we try to air these rather large questions. And one thing I'll note is also, in Britain, for example, the blogosphere doesn't play this role. Because they actually have a parliament. Whereas this country doesn't, essentially. It has a joke of a Congress in which no one's really debating. And no one listens to the debates. And no one's really accountable in those debates. And no one's even listening to these politicians make speeches. It's an empty chamber. So when you remove essentially the arguments of parliamentary democracy, and when you turn campaigns into what they've become, that's why I think also the debates in this campaign have turned into so important. Because there are no real debates like that happening, either on cable, which is dedicated to certain lines, or in the Congress. So when you have a campaign like this in which the blogosphere is interacting with these debates, and that is, in some ways, the driving force behind the narrative of the campaign, at least one of the driving forces, then I think you see why the blogosphere has an important role, because the public debate in this city is so atrophied.
Great. So let's open up for questions. Chris, could you give us a hand with the microphone up here at the table and maybe...
Can I take a whiz break for 1 second?
Sure. Let's take five and then we will...
No, you can keep going. I'll just disappear and come back.
No problem.
You'll want to take your mic off, I think.
Yeah, no, that would be funny.
That's what the people need to hear.
Yeah. If you could just use the microphone, because we will be reposting this on the web.
So academic philosophy and political blogging have one feature in common, which is that they both tend to be very dominated by white males. There's a lack of visibility of females and minorities in both sorts of professions. And this is something that I think both the communities are trying to engage in various tactics to try to combat and change. And I'm just wondering, do you guys see anything that you can do or that you are doing that is aiming to try to help change that situation?
Matt?
Sure. I think that one thing that you especially see in the blogging world, because it's a little bit undefined, you know, what constitutes a political blog, and that part of the way the sort of dynamic, at least in a gender sense, came into creation is that there was a construction of what constituted the political blogs so as to exclude the majority of women who were writing things on the internet about issues that were of some importance and had some mix of things that are also trivial. You sort of see that all the time, and part of the change that I think, you know, has had to happen is simply to, you know, reconsider like which websites are the political ones, that like Jezebel.com is not a website about politics, but many of the articles on it are on political topics, and many of the articles, you know, I wrote something about like why the New Orleans Hornets might have a more successful business if they were in Albuquerque, and that's not a political topic. It's just something I was interested in and was thinking about, you know? And so it's like, it's okay for some of my posts to be like that without it becoming like a men's interest blog, even though it's disproportionately men who might be interested in that subject. So that I think is sort of the main thing on the most conceptual level, and is sharply different from an academic world in which like there are very formal barriers and processes, and I don't really know anything about.
And then John.
I'm curious about a phenomenon. I'm not sure if there is a word for it in the blogosphere. I think of it as comment jacking, as in hijacking. And I'm thinking of it in regard to how blogging can or can't be philosophy. I mean, Andrew said that he considers, you know, virtually normal the most important work he's done. And I imagine it's partly because you worked so hard. It was a great book. I liked it very much. You hone the arguments, it's systematic, you consider lots of options and so on. Now, I dealt for the first time with comment jacking. I write regularly for the Chronicle of Higher Education, and we were urged to kind of pay attention to the comments on our pieces and maybe intervene and so on. And I noticed this phenomenon where the first 10 comments or so, or 15, are on the article, and then people start zapping each other and going off into strange territory. And if you actually came back in to say, well, the original point was it's kind of egotistical, you're pulling it back to your article, and so you end up with a lot of zigzags and red herrings and non sequiturs and so on, all of which seems to me not in line with philosophy as we've thought of it. Philosophy doesn't have to be perfectly linear and syllogistic, but it has to be roughly on a clear path. So I wonder if you could speak to that. I'm not clear myself whether in blogging that happens as much as in the publication of articles by you know, places like The Chronicle, where people just take it in their own direction. But is comment jacking a phenomenon in the blogosphere that, in a sense, undermines its possibilities as philosophy because it ends up Rube Goldberg-like?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I blog on climate change, so I've never had this problem. you know, one of the things, blogs started off with a very, it was a small number of bloggers and a small number of people reading them, and so there was this real utopianism early on, it seems to me, about the possibilities of dialogue. But as things have gotten bigger, it turns out that creating this community of friends that Andrew was talking about, and this community of interlocutors, is an effortful it's undertaking. It does not happen just because you put a blog post on the web and let all comers in. It takes really careful and intense work to build up a community of people that can have a productive dialogue. And I find, and maybe you guys find this too, that in terms of valuable interactions, I have more on email now than in my blog comments, obviously, because Grist is tiny and underpowered and doesn't really have the manpower to do the work it would take to really tend this garden of. So I mean, but for me, it's email and Twitter and even physical conversations. And I feel like the more you go to a sort of a big anonymous institutional blog, like any newspaper, go to any newspaper site and read the comments for a truly existential dread, or YouTube. YouTube is the ultimate sewer of.
I don't have comments. I got rid of them. Well, I never had them in the first place. Which was my way out of this. I wish I could be high-minded about it and say I thought about the future of philosophical discourse and decided not to have them. In fact, at the very beginning, I was just terrified someone would libel somebody and I would be held responsible, since when I was just doing it by myself in my bedroom for 6 years. But it turned out that turned into a blessing, in as much as what happened was that the emails we got started to become, once you set a tone of respect and discourse about certain serious questions. And we've had the theodicy question debated. We've had you know, the existence of God. All sorts of things go on the dish that don't happen on many other blogs. And part of the reason for that is that a huge amount of the content that we now create is reader-generated. And it comes in through emails that we edit and select and curate for the smartest. And then I will respond to it. So the most days there'll be some sort of dissent of the day from a reader. Or there'll be entire reader threads, which are entirely their argument. But we will monitor that argument and facilitate it and edit it. And they will, in return, have no name tagging at all. Like, they will get no name recognition. It's all anonymous. So it's all a reader writes. So lots of people have contributed from you know, a homemaker in the Midwest to a congressman, and they're all the same anonymity. And we actually edit it for precisely staying on point or adding new points, and then force me, this is part of the general pain of my position, to respond successfully or unsuccessfully, or to change. I have to say, though, that that however hard Virtue Normal was to write, I have never, ever worked as hard as in blogging. It is an absolutely grueling endeavor. Now, I'm a little strange because I put up 270 posts a week, which is a very large number. Now, I do it with the help of a small little staff that have been trained now for years, at least a couple of them have been trained for years. so that we can keep it. But blogging at that volume and at that scale, there are six of us, if you include interns, reaching 1.5 million people. That's the number of producers for consumers is huge. And it is mind-numbingly exhausting. The sheer drain by the end of the year or after a few months, I am physically wrecked. What? It's true, right?
I guess. I think it's fun. I don't know.
Matt is one of these people who writes for fun, even when he's on vacation. He's subject to much envy and loathing among fellow bloggers for that reason.
Can I not get any love on that? You're just contemptuous.
I write maybe one post a day, maybe one every other day. They tend to be long, and I find that exhausting. So 270 a week I don't have a frame of reference for that.
Jonathan.
So two things happened in the last hour that are the premises of my question. The first is the disembodied voice we heard in the next room was that of Professor Lucius Outlaw, who's giving the Dewey lecture. And I think the spirit of Dewey hung heavy in part of this conversation, along with Dick Rorty. The second is that I've been tweeting, unauthorized tweeting. And Twitter I hate, because it's like standing under a waterfall of opinion, but I do find myself once in a while taking a look at it. So in the 30s, Dewey had a debate with Walter Lippmann on the question whether the public sense of itself, a coherent sense of the public, is necessary for a democratic polity. Lippmann said it isn't. The public is a phantom. Give it up. We have to have democracy without a public sense of itself. Dewey desperately tries to save the idea of the public. In The Public and Its Problems, a book he wrote. But he's very worried about it because there are so many damn voices in modernity. So my question is, does the idea of a public, a self-aware, coherent public, make sense in the era, not just of blogging? I'd like to hear you guys say something more than was already said by David about tweeting. Can you develop a public sense in 140 characters, which should be a Gertrude Stein play, it seems to me, or are we undermining the sense of the public, not only through blogging and all the voices, and it's wonderful that so many smart people can do this without an editor, but how does tweeting fit in?
You know, one of the interesting things about blogging and tweeting and about social media generally and the democratization of media generally is it seems to me a lot of sort of romantic, good and bad, romantic notions about the great unwashed masses have been sort of rudely disrupted when the unwashed masses started talking, when they started talking for themselves, and you hear this about blog comments too, but you also, so I don't know about a sense of the public, but I always craved when I was in school a grand public dialogue. That's always sort of what I wanted out of philosophy. And it seems to me that one is happening now. It's imperfect and ugly and, you have to use the word tweet. But it's happening, and that's, I can't imagine that that's anything but a good thing.
You know, what I think is interesting, particularly about Twitter as a platform, is that it allows for through hashtags and things like that, people and retweeting, people engage in these little sort of solidaristic gestures, to indicate, just to like affiliate themselves with certain points of view and certain causes. And so you can actually see in a way that was only sort of hypothetical in the broadcast newspaper age, the idea of, is there some set of people out there who are moving in some direction or not, right? Like, which topics are people interested in and engaging in, and which aren't they, and which which causes bring people together, you know.
Justin Bieber's paternity test.
Yeah, for instance. No, but I mean, but you see it. You do see it on you know on substantive issues. That I mean, I think there's a some bill in Congress now called the Stop Online Piracy Act, which obviously is of a lot of concern to the sort of early adopter demographic. But you can actually see in real time through social media people trying to kind of organize themselves against that. Or you could see that. When the House Republicans were doing their like Planned Parenthood funding attack, that was something that, you know, there's lots of issues that people talk about, but that was an issue that a lot of the kind of people who were online felt they had a personal relationship with and were speaking about, and people were sort of reposting, you know, other people's views on it. So the idea of like mass opinion becomes in some ways a much more concrete sort of phenomenon. Which in some ways makes it, you know, more difficult to be like too utopian about. But at the same time, I mean, I think the idea of a public sphere and of a mass public has always played, you know, an important kind of justificatory role in democracy. And so it's useful to have some sense that you can say, like, well, no, this is where the public square, like, actually is, right? I mean, that opinion could manifest itself here and in these platforms, and we can tell if people are paying attention or not. You know, I try to be helpful about things. So, I think that's the good. Many of Lippmann's old remarks still seem to have a lot of force, I think, to everyone, but so it goes.
I found tweeting a little silly myself. I mean, partly because I'm lucky to already establish a big readership in a blog, so that I don't need to get more by tweeting, and also because there is just a limit. I mean, a tweet is sort of almost just a vote. I mean, it's not occasionally it's a good line, rarely. I find the amount that you have to get through to find those gems to be pretty arduous activity. I would say, however, that who are people tweeting to? Like, who are they blogging for? It's a question that everybody who's doing it must have an answer to. Now, some of them will be their friends to impress or to stimulate. But I do think, and this is, you know, you're talking about sort of a Habermasian sort of public square, as it were, of equality and discourse. I still have in my head a concept, a slightly narrower, which is more to do with writing, which is a general reader. I mean, I was often asked, for example, with Virtue Normal, who is this for? Who's this book for? Yeah, obviously, it's a gay book, right? It's for gays. I'm like, no, it's for a general reader. Just that the conservative soul is for a general reader, meaning I hope anybody can read this and be persuaded by it. And I think the difference between a good blogger and a bad one, in a way, is whether one is writing for a general reader and one is writing for propagandistic or rallying purposes, which is not for general reader. It's an instrumental use of blogging to corral a certain political constituency around a certain set of goals or candidates or whatever. And that is more like being a political party than being part of a political discourse. One of the things that I try and do, and Matt actually is the unfortunate beneficiary of an award in his name, is when people are openly able to say, you know, I don't agree with a lot of people on my side on this because of this, or I've changed my mind. Those kind of moments when the person ceases to be a propagandist and starts appealing to a general reader, because who else would care if they changed their mind? That's hopeful to me. That's more hopeful to me, that the impulse to tweet and blog is an impulse not entirely narcissistic.
Yeah, if I could just say one more quick thing about that.
Quickly, and then we've got some people on.
One of the great things about social media, and I think Andrew was a pioneer in sort of showing this, is you find that there are publics, plural, and that you can shift between them. So I write about, you know, I write about the environment, and then, you know, I can write about TV shows, and I tweet funny quotes from my kids, and so, you know, I'm sort of allowed to be a person, a full person in public. And I think that helps I think that's attractive to people, and that's, and I think that's what Andrew showed through his blog, is he's a human being with a full range of interests, and so that that lends something to any individual post that that specialization always obscured for me. But
Here.
Hello. I have a question, I guess, somewhat methodological. Perhaps you addressed this somewhat early on in your comments. In 2010, I published a book called Consuming Choices, which is a book about consumer ethics and whether the notion of buying ethical is a character choice or whether it's actually a moral obligation. So I was trying to get at, apply some rigorous philosophy to a question that a lot of people had already sort of glommed onto but hadn't really thought about a lot. And I very much wanted to reach the general reader. And the publisher, of course, had difficulty getting wrapping their heads around that exactly. And I did that somewhat by putting the technical stuff in two chapters and the non-technical stuff up front and at the end. And so after the book was published, I was approached by a group, Care 2 in California, about, I guess, being a blogger or being some sort of contributor. And I was very excited about that because, wow, okay, now I can really reach out and get to a lot of people. And I wrote one or two posts, but I eventually realized it became overwhelming. And part of the reason was I felt like I was having to write these little philosophical journal articles every week, right? Because my standards of writing as a philosopher were at one point, and that was just not conducive to putting it out at the rate that was sort of, and so it's just sort of atrophied and I'm not doing it. So any advice, any thoughts about this? Or is this a fundamental tension between trying to be, on the one hand, employed as an academic philosopher, because there's some worry then if, you know, I was deathly worried I was gonna say something in this post and then some professional philosopher was gonna come along and say, well, you know,
you're toast. That's a worry.
Yeah, exactly. So any thoughts you might share on that would be very helpful.
Try staying up till 1 a.m. You find you get your standards and start to drop a little.
I mean, I'd really like to do it, but time-wise and mentally, it's tough.
You have to lower your standards. I think that's one. But honestly and openly do so. What you say is that this is not written as a finished work of academic philosophy. It's not. It's a conversation I'm having around these ideas, which I concede in advance are subject to my subsequent revision and amendment. I mean, I think that's the move you have to make, or else you'll be paralyzed, because you just can't produce a perfect post every day about substantive issues, because human beings just aren't like that. So it's mistaking the form. It's more like the conversations you'd have with students after class as they are chatting with you walking through the quad. That's more of what you're doing. Now, sometimes those moments will be really useful and interesting, actually, and people will ask some rather direct questions that you probably, when you were sitting alone writing a book, didn't force you to change what you were writing, but subsequently might. So I think just understanding a different context and to understand that argument can take place at different levels. And this is why the Platonic dialogues are still, for me, sort of archetypes, because in fact, they're very accessible. I mean, you know, they're not. And they're based on the same principle, which is that we're not gonna lay out a cast iron roadmap to something we call the truth. This is a dialectic and a dialogue which, with any luck, will help us better understand where we are. Which, frankly, I think is more honest than the pretensions of post-war journalism that Matt delineated.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I think the right way to think about it is that the argument is the blog, it's not the post, right? That a post, it's short, it's saying what you think, it's connecting to something that seemed worthy of connection, and people will raise objections. But then that becomes the next two or three or four, you know, things you write. It's like, what about this? What about that? You know, what about this? And that becomes the answer to both, like, how can I get the one thing out the door in a quick enough fashion? And also, well, what the heck am I gonna write about tomorrow? Right. I mean, it's precisely sort of responding to those things. Whenever I talk to people who are in academia in all different contexts, this is obviously, you know, the concern that gets raised. But everyone, you know, before they submit their papers to the journals, is going through a process where they're saying something about their ideas, and they're hearing responses, and they're trying to produce counterarguments, and, you know, eventually it gets worked up into the final form. But you know, the internet is a medium for expressing, I think, the earlier versions of the thought, or even just the quickest iteration of the argument, and then you see what people come up with. And
the trouble is, I think that career academics look down on other academics who are blogging, like they look down on them that publish in general interest magazines or that appear on television, and so you have that problem. But that's just the problem of the academy's insecurity and defensiveness about itself, I think. But it's not really inherent to the question of blogging. It's the question of whether you want to lose your job.
the fact is, though,
important question.
I think wait till tenure and then blog away.
The fact is, though, if you write every day, you will say stupid things, and you will make lots of errors, and you will get called on them, and you will probably hate it every time, as I continue to hate it every single time.
In the New York Times. Making errors.
Yes, right. I know. You might make an error someday that finds its way to the New York Times.
The Academy is based upon this sort of mystique of authority in which these professors are flawless and hand out pearls of wisdom, and that's what's unhealthy.
To Dave's credit, though, since he did just mention the mistake in the New York Times, he was also cited several times by Paul Krugman in his posts about how important it was that the Obama administration passed the Mercury rules.
That is the very post in which the error appeared, I'm afraid. Why am I saying this on camera?
Both sides are, you know, you got some good and bad out of it.
Pollution is bad.
Yeah, pollution is still bad. Okay.
Thank you. I had two questions for Andrew. And I wanted to say, first of all, I really appreciate the dish and its philosophical dimensions. I've actually assigned threads to my classes before, talking about the existence of God, for instance, and they come so much more alive debating that than, you know, Descartes' third meditation. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
I was wondering if you could say a little more. You actually started to in the end of your response to the last question about you said your time at Harvard and philosophy had been all but killed off there. Of course, you're being a little hyperbolic, but, you know, I think if we're honest with ourselves, those of us who are in the academy, we, you know, admit that there's some truth to that. So I'd like to hear your thoughts about why you think that happened, or when it happened, or if it's always been the case. And my second question is, how in God's name do you filter all of that information on the dish?
To answer the last question is that I do what I can. I mean, we get, I don't know, how many, like 600-700 emails a day, something like that, 500, something. I don't know, it's nuts. And I'm not the only one that now goes through it, because it just simply would be, it's physically impossible to read them. But what happens is you just get a technique of doing that for 12 years of scanning emails, and you just get a knack of finding the one that might just say something interesting or different. And then you also get to know certain readers who you know are always smart and have something interesting to say. And then every now and again, a handful of them, I give my personal email because they're so smart and know so much and can tell me so much that I don't want to miss what they have to say. As for academic philosophy, I do think that the question, how should I live my life, should be the first question for a philosopher. And that's not the same thing as saying, how do I make sense of a sentence that says, how should I live my life? Now, I'm not arguing that that linguistic question isn't vital and important and interesting. I am arguing that if philosophy and the general philosophical discipline loses contact with the most important questions that human beings have asked themselves forever and will continue to ask themselves forever about the meaning of their lives, the relationship of them to other human beings, the relationship of the city to philosophy, all the great eternal questions of philosophy, I think it's a great shame, because I think there's always hunger for that. And when you see it, when you see political theory departments, for example, basically bursting at the seams because that's the only place people can really go read a variety of the great philosophers which can engage them. And look, I'll be honest with you. I also like the informality and freedom of being a public intellectual without being tied to academic duties and academic politics, primarily. I don't want to be down on the academy because I revere it, and respect it. But it wasn't for me, and partly because I could see myself getting involved in these bitter controversies over extremely esoteric issues that really would not illuminate my life or give it meaning and direction. Whereas this public philosophizing, I always remember, it's probably politically incorrect, but the dude who brought me my Chinese food one night, he was a messenger, comes into my lobby way, and in my entranceway there are all sorts of books. He says, "Oh, Aristotle, Plato, we share same interest." I'm like, "Yeah, that's $24. But I realized then, you know, that yeah, people are interested in this stuff. They're genuinely, one thing that I'm amazed by is how many people are prepared to sit down and write long letters that they have no guarantee will be printed, that their name, even if it is printed, will not appear, arguing about why they've grappled with theodicy and come out the other side. That to me is amazing. Or for example, I'll give you another simple example of why I find it exhilarating, is that I made an offhand remark once about why I didn't agree with partial birth abortions after the assassination of George Tiller. And the next day I get an email from a woman who'd had a last trimester abortion. And she told me her story about she'd always wanted, been trying to have a child for 10 years. Finally, it worked through fertility treatments. And the terrible story that she told of the choice she had to either let her child die within minutes of being born or reduce the pain and some of it by aborting it in advance. And just by the end of the letter, I was like, I don't know what to say. I printed it. And then another 15 to 20 letters come in from women. Now, how would a regular reporter have found that, those people, at that moment, and persuaded them to tell their stories, and illuminated debate at the moment that it was happening, and changed my mind, actually, on the question? That was a case in point in which these readers were telling their own experiences, but clearly in telling them were wrestling with very profound questions about the taking of human life at its most precious, when you are most connected to it. So I think there's a huge hunger and thirst out there among the public, but there's a huge inhibition, not to sound stupid. And I think that one of the things that blogs can do, and why I don't have comments but do this, is to edit the people. Edit the vox populi in a way that makes it more intelligible. But I'm also staggered by the quality of the input. I mean, journalism was really, I think, in many ways, a scam. I mean, it's not that hard to do. Reporting is hard to do and takes time and effort to do. And that's a skill, a technique, mainly in deception. I mean, Janet Malcolm was onto something. But for the rest of us, you know, thinking about the world, ordinary people who aren't given a qualification as a journalist are often much better, have more expertise, know a specific area better than anybody generalist ever would, or have an argument. You know, they're smart. I think that we, every man with a and woman with a Facebook page has a potential blog. You know, and you find that happening too. That Facebook is really expanding into a blogosphere in which. Which is also connecting now with the other blogosphere, so that we're all having this broader conversation, and every man and woman is a blogger, which is in itself an advance in citizenship of a sort. In as much as I know, yes, I'm trying to look on the bright side of things, but the fact that individual human beings are voicing opinions among their peers when they're not going to town hall meetings, you know, it is the equivalent.
Bill? And I've got three more hands that I've seen, and then we'll be wrapping it up.
My question, I don't have a rich practice of reading blogs, and so from the outside it looks chaotic and unimaginably vast. So My question basically is going to boil down to, if you take seriously your commitment to creating good arguments in a dialectical context, right, of multiple other blogs, the academy, or journalism, how do you think we could improve what bloggers do in terms of practices? Like, what practices, if bloggers adopted them, maybe informed partly by philosophy, would the quality of blogs improve? And so that's going to be my basic question. And I have a few things I'm going to throw out, and then I'd like an answer.
Maybe just one thing.
One is links. I would imagine you guys have a burden of links. Like, every factual claim you make could be linked, and those links themselves could be good or bad, and then that could be referenced. And then the other issue is maybe the mental labor issue, you know, which I'm hearing a lot of. If there's multiple blogs and somebody else has made the same argument and they've done it quicker, better, and more concise, do you really want to spend that time, you know, on your own creating the same arguments you've made somewhere else? And that goes back to the linking issue. And so I don't know if there's some kind of, like, in the future, a meta adjudicator site or something that will, you know, a self-proclaimed meta adjudicator site that'll try to create I'll leave it there.
You know, I think the sort of the worst habit that people get into in the blogosphere, and you know, I fall into it and I try to resist it, and it's a constant temptation, but is to go for the sort of the lowest hanging argumentative fruit, to find, you know, the dumbest thing somebody said today and be like, that's stupid. Or to take something that someone famous and well known did and was maybe poorly worded, and then if you give it like the least generous possible reading, you can easily refute it. And you know, that's it's a bad habit of scholarship. It's a bad habit, you know, in the seminar. It's a bad habit on the internet, because the world, you know, doesn't really, really need like a million iterations about why wrong things that are obviously wrong are obviously wrong. What it needs is people with the courage and the discipline to take on like the strong arguments, or to even say like, here's the best reading I can give of what this other guy had said. Here's what I think is valid in what someone whose overall perspective I disagree with is saying. You know, and to always be trying to sort of, you know, raise the game in that regard. And it's hard because, you know, of course, it's also a business, it's a job. You need to, you know, get a certain amount of stuff out. You need to send your links around. And so there's a temptation to sort of fall on that. But I think as a community, you know, of readers and writers, and hopefully producing useful knowledge for the world, it's better to go after the hard stuff.
Yeah, I would just say that, I mean, I totally agree with that, and could probably, you know, have my own list of best practices, but I would just strongly push back against this urge, which has popped up since the very beginning of the blogosphere, for people wanting to sort of make it behave better, or adjudicate it somehow, or somehow officiate it, or somehow produce standards. You know, there's sort of this blog cliche at this point, we need a blogger ethics panel, because bloggers are constantly being lectured to by journalists about missteps that journalists in fact make all the time, but hide behind, you know, objectivity to make. So I totally understand the reaction of saying, good Lord, it's a ginormous, it's unfathomably vast and complex. I mean, Andrew's blog alone is unfathomably vast and complex. But you know, the answer to what to do to make the blogosphere better or to spread best practices is just start a blog and do it the way you think it ought to be done and hope to lead by example. I really don't think anything beyond that is needed.
And Andrew, you've actually written about the importance of the technological innovation of hyperlink.
Yeah.
For like what might appear to be superficiality of a blog, especially shortness, right? Actually, there's this depth, which is the follow, similar to the way in Montaigne's essays, your comparison, not mine, in the different editions of the essays, you actually get, right, the same kind of iterative
exactly.
You know, process.
I would say that if I would say one thing that really is good etiquette, and which actually is generally abided by, is that if you are criticizing an argument made elsewhere, that you provide a link to that argument, which I might add is impossible in print magazines. So you can read some diatribe. I have no idea really what the original arguments were. So one of the reasons that helps is that the reader can then test, you know, whether you're bullshitting or whether you're distorting or whether you're fairly engaging another person. So that is an amazing thing in a way, if you think about it, because if you think that there's enormous polarization, which is right, and that's, I think the blogosphere reflects that rather than creates it, but it certainly doesn't help that question. But when you're watching Fox News, you won't suddenly get a click to watch a bit of the MSNBC version of it so that you can see exactly what's going on, whereas you can if you read most good blogs. And I think that's a critical good practice, which is very simple. And some people disobey. Like National Review has a policy of never linking to my blog because I'm to be ostracized from the conservative conversation because that's the way they operate. I think that's bad etiquette myself, but I certainly am not. I'm certainly not going to stop linking to them if only 30% of it's in positive. The other thing I would say is that if someone has said something much better than you, a link to it, say it, quote it. That's what we do all the time. A lot of my posts, it sounds like they're more ambitious than they are. No, they're not. They're often them just like Matt Yglesias really has a humdinger today. Check it out. Here's the money quote. And that's a post. You know, it sometimes I regard myself as a blogger almost like a DJ rather than editor, in which I'm remixing the conversation around the web in as interesting and as diverse a way as possible, framed around my own sensibility, tastes, and arguments, so that there's a core every day of my own opinions, but there is a huge amount of other material. And I really like the fact that a reader can look at the dish and go to a post and then, for example, each day we've been doing a Syria roundup. And you can go into those posts, you can briefly look it through and look at the YouTubes, but there's a dozen links in them. Mm-hmm. You can learn more from that one post of reading. And again, rather like the gentleman said about questions of theodicy, funnily enough, dialogue actually is a better way of engaging people in interesting subjects. If you give them a tome to read and digest as an authority, there's a natural tendency to just sort of be bored or not really want to do it. Whereas if you overhear a conversation in which someone makes a strong point, you're immediately drawn in by your own response. So that I find in a way it's a more effective way of learning about subjects than the traditional top-down enterprise. As for advice, I would start with the dish, and we have a huge list of bloggers on the side, and I would find out links and which links you like best, and eventually you'll have your own RSS feed of stuff that you like.
Yes, curation is the signal skill of the 21st century, it seems.
Right behind you, Chris.
Personally and curating other people's stuff.
And then you'll be last.
One of the repeated topics in this conversation.
Could you speak up a little bit?
I can, but the echo's awfully odd. One of the continually emerging themes in this conversation is the distinction between what happens on blogs and what happens in traditional journalism. The ability to risk being wrong, the ability to engage in dialogue, the ambiguous distinction between, say, a political blog and a Facebook update page or something like that. Since we have some philosophically sophisticated bloggers up here.
And we also have print journalists in the room, I'll just remind them.
Well, how does this ambiguity affect the relationship between the traditional special privileges given to journalists and bloggers? I mean, admit, my wager is that everybody up on that stage there has more readers than my local newspaper, for example. I mean, you certainly do. I didn't hear exact numbers. How does that work, do you think?
You stumped us, haven't you? How does it work in the sense that I mean, to some extent, it seems to me that there is two categories. One is pure reporting, which I think could be done by good bloggers in a different kind of way, but is essentially important. Being there, witnessing things as a professional, not just as an amateur. as trying to find an objective position in the middle of a civil war, where most of the data we're getting from Syria, for example, is from clearly one side of the conflict. And I have a feeling that in the long run, that's going to have to be philanthropically supported. And I think that you will then have, and begin to have, as well as there'll be one or two major news organizations capable of doing this kind of stuff, the New York Times, the BBC, maybe the Guardian, the Times newspapers if they survive Murdoch, and so on and so forth. And then the rest will be our ability to present that information in interesting ways. You know, I'm a great admirer of ProPublica, but no one wants to go there every day to read the stories. I mean, they just don't. And the truth is, I'm also come from a British tradition of journalism, which is get readers, keep them interested. What's a good story? What's good copy? You know, all that. How do you keep them engaged? So I see, in some ways, the relationship becoming one in which there is a core fact-producing reporting endeavor, and in which some people are paid over careers to hone that craft. And then the rest of us who will find a way to bring that in a lively manner to as many people as possible, competing in our DJing to make it as interesting and as diverse as possible. And that means that we're becoming newspapers. We are essentially, I mean, I think you could read The Dish, and my ambition is that a person could read The Dish and really not miss any major news story or debate of the day, even if it's only a touched upon. But it's so that we will become the gateway to reporting and be an opinionated, lively gateway to that.
But I mean, I think there's a sort of specific question about the political, legal, and just sort of general normative status that journalists sort of have in a democratic society. You know, which is simply that, for example, I mean, government officials and agencies feel themselves typically to be under a certain obligation to respond to an inquiry from, like, a journalist at a news organization. But if you look in my neighborhood here in Washington, we have there's a guy who, as a hobby, writes a blog about the neighborhood and about, you know, real estate development and crime and you know, local issues that are in there. He doesn't have a very large audience because only 2,000 people even live in the neighborhood. He has, though, a huge proportion of those 2,000 people read his site, and I would say it is of vital importance, social importance, that if he makes inquiries that are relevant to the beat that he has assigned himself, that people, you know, that city officials and so forth take that very seriously, because even though his audience isn't large, it's very dedicated among the people who are relevantly impacted, and because that kind of reporting is the kind of thing which has fallen away in commercial news elements. The local TV news, you know, they'll cover a mayoral election, but they are not getting in the weeds of, does this developer really have the correct permit, that he's supposed to have. And I think something that the disruption of these definitional boundaries has revealed is that we never really had, I think, a super clear account of, like, who the journalists are. That a journalistic institution has always been, or at least has long been, this kind of odd mishmash of, like, guys who write book reviews, you know, hard-boiled war correspondents, someone who just puts together a report about the weather.
Phone hackers.
Yeah, and you know, what do they really all have in common? It's actually just that they're getting employed by a certain set of institutions, and we've decided that, you know, those are the newspapers. So we're going to have to sort of, you know, re-evolve how those things are. I don't think you need a rule that gives you, you know, like a definitive answer 100% of the time. But then it helps us, you know, think about just the general role of information and citizens in a democracy, and what kind of openness and what kind of responsiveness should we really, you know, come to expect from everyone all the time. You know, in one of the things that you see in a digital age is that there's much less objective constraint on institutions' ability to disseminate the information about what they're doing, right? And the norm really ought to be that all kinds of I think, public things are sort of put out to be passively received by whoever wants them, so you don't have this same kind of question of like, well, is it my job to pick up the phone when so-and-so calls? I don't know, that's provisional.
And we had one final question in front.
Well, I hate to be the final question, but so this is mostly towards Andrew, but also hits a little bit on several topics that have been talked about. And Matt, your point about actually seeing progress across society on big ideas. And that's just the simple notion of being wrong and being willing to say, I was wrong. And here are the arguments that have changed my mind. And here's the evidence that I've seen. And here's how I've learned this. Andrew, I was one of those loyal readers that were friends from hell that have tried to push you back from the Ron Paul endorsement, for example, or many other. And many times you've done this. I mean, thank you. I like the other commenter here. I've used some of your threads, particularly the times when you've said you were wrong in my philosophy classroom. Because not to oversimplify, but I think simply saying, starting from a premise, I could be wrong with any position, and then actually listening to opposing arguments, wrestling through them, and then coming out the other side, and then not mincing words, but saying clearly, I was wrong, and here's why, here are these arguments. There's just an incredible dearth of that in our society today. You just don't see it outside of many other places besides your blogs. So first of all, thank you for just being an example. Like you said, the Platonic dialogue is a rational discourse in this way. But more my question is, how do we, in terms of philosophy and public engagement, you know, philosophy trying to engage the public sphere, this is, I think, the heart of the matter. Rational engagement is simply being able to say I was wrong, saying that clearly, and showing the arguments for why you think you were wrong and have changed your mind. How do we engage the broader culture like that? You don't see this in the political world. You don't see this in mainstream news media. I mean, a newspaper the next day might print a small little correction, right, buried way deep in some back page. So how do we, so good job doing that. I think that's what philosophy is. How do we expand on that? How do we try to approach
society? Well, it's humiliating. I mean, I think that's the first thing to say. It is humiliating in a good sense if your ultimate goal is to get to what's right. You never get to the point of being glad you've been shown you're wrong. Even, I know a true philosopher is thrilled when he's refuted.
I have not yet. He has a fallacy named after him. That's even better. Right?
I have not yet reached that level of enlightenment. I think the other thing is that when you blog in real time, not only do you have more ability to put pressure because you can keep at it every bloody day, you know. Like when it was suddenly clear that the United States was torturing prisoners in grotesque fashion, and you know, David Brooks can go 5 years without ever writing a column about it. But I, as a blogger, having discovered it, was able to write about it 3 or 4 times a day in a way that an editor would tell me, oh, for God's sake, that's enough. Mm-hmm. And I can make an extreme, passionate cause like that. But obviously, inevitably, then you make errors. I think that simply the pressure of being that public requires you, when something has been pointed out, that you're just sitting there squirming, and when your readers are saying your last attempt to respond to this was pathetic and didn't really address any of the issues, you then, what I did after a week on the Ron Paul stuff was sit down and read those bloody newsletters and really think to myself, I don't believe this is him, but nonetheless, it's got his bloody name on it and he took money from it, and how can that man be president? Then I was able to write this tortured attempt to sort of not walk back those parts of it that I still agreed with, but to walk back a detail. That's I learned that through blogging, and I think I learned it mainly through the Iraq War. I mean, we can watch my blog as it staggers onto the truth unwittingly. I remember writing the headline. So where are they? About the weapons of mass destruction. I remember writing that post thinking, shit, this is going to get the neocons upset, all my friends, because I'm sorry, but they were already talking about democracy. I was like, oh, can we just resolve this question that was the basis of the war? And from that moment on, the journey began. But I don't think as a blogger, I could have sustained it without, I think the requirement of of constructing a lie against the obvious reality would have made me feel utterly unworthy as a public intellectual. And somehow being so on the spot constantly makes that harder to duck, because they're at your in your face every day. I'm so disappointed in you. How could you say that? I always knew you were a fascist. All that kind of stuff that you get. These people who feel like they've known you for 10 years, what I mean by friendship. This is my first time ever writing you. I'm so crushed that you've done this, that, and the other. I'm not reading you anymore. That's a lot of pressure. You certainly will never get that from Bill Keller every day if you write some bullshit. And you will not be able to avoid whole areas of discourse that you can if you're a weekly columnist. You can just duck for a while and then come out later when it's obvious what the right thing is.
Yeah, I also feel like maybe I'm being too optimistic here, but having blogs as an example of iterative and humble writing and thinking just casts a really harsh light on a lot of what passes for elite, opinion. Like you mentioned David Brooks or Ruth Marcus or Tom Friedman. It's hard to read David Brooks week by week with blogs as a contrast and not just feel like he literally is not hearing, he's in a cave somewhere. Like he writes about David Brooks every week and somehow like has heard none of these criticisms of David Brooks that have been so common in the blogosphere as to become cliches and have awards named after them and have memes, somehow he's managed never to hear those, or else he's heard them and is perfectly willing to act out this absurd role.
Because his main readership is Bill Keller. He's not directly answerable to his readers the way that we are.
But it becomes glaring, I think, after a while. And I feel like maybe the political readership is getting slightly more sophisticated and that's becoming less... I hope that's becoming less acceptable.
Final thought, Matt?
No.
Okay. All right. Well, I want to wrap this up and thank all of you for coming. I want to thank Andrew and Matthew and David for spending the afternoon with us. I, in some part, was attracted to organizing this panel because I thought, well, we need another answer to why should I major in philosophy other than because it helps you on the LSAT, of which I know there are lots of good answers, but I think this is maybe one that many of us hadn't thought of before. And I don't know that this will be at the top of your list when you're looking at your classrooms and at your brightest students, but I do think that clearly my conclusion from this session is that some combination of philosophical sensitivity and the particular demands of this medium is something that ought to be encouraged whenever possible, because I do think it has the capacity to enrich our lives and our public. So thank you all very much.